The objective of this topic is the history of liver abscess, different type of liver abscess, the pathogenesis of liver abscess, different clinical feature of liver abscess, the investigations needed for the liver abscess, medical and surgical management of liver abscess, what are the recent advances in management of liver abscess, and few interesting case reports. The history of liver abscess. Liver abscess is not detected now. It was detected in the ancient time, since the Hippocrates time. The Osler also documented amoeba both in stool as well as abscess in the same patient. Dyelaphi first described multiple liver abscess in same person. Second uveitis and appendicitis. What is the definition of liver abscess? Hepatic or liver abscess are infectious space-occupying lesion in the liver. We know the most two common types are pyogenic liver abscess and amoebic liver abscess. There are various types of liver abscess like pyogenic liver abscess, amoebic liver abscess, fungal liver abscess, and hydatids become infected and produces liver abscess. There are reports of tuberculosis liver abscess also. The incidence and epidemiology of liver abscess. In total intra-abdominal abscess, liver abscess carried around 30% of intra-abdominal abscess. It carries around 48% of all visceral abscess. The mortality due to liver abscess is around 5 to 30% in all cases. The most common cause of death in a liver abscess is due to sepsis, multi-organ failure, and hepatic failure. The incidence is more or less equal between male and female, but the male carries worst prognosis or poor prognosis compared to female. Now we'll see the different etiology of pyogenic liver abscess. The most common etiology is biliary tract origin, followed by portal vein and hepatic artery, direct causes, cryptogenic causes, and miscellaneous. Each and everything now we'll see in detail. This is a video for different causes of pyogenic liver abscess. First is biliary origin. Any pathology in the gallbladder or biliary tract can produce pyogenic liver abscess. Second is via the portal vein. Any pathology in the mesenteric vessels spread via the portal vein and reaches the liver produces liver abscess. And third most important is via the hepatic artery, reaches the ciliary trunk and produces liver abscess. And the fourth important etiology is direct causes. Maybe a blunt trauma or penetrating trauma can produce this liver abscess. First, we will see the biliary origin. Biliary origin can be a benign or malignant etiology. Benign is mostly cholelithiasis, cholecystitis, following biliary entry anastomosis, endoscopic biliary procedure, or percutaneous biliary procedure, and ascending cholangitis. The most common etiology is usually following stone pathology. The malignant etiologies usually include a common bile duct cancer or gallbladder malignancy, periampullary carcinoma, or carcinoma head of pancreas. The important feature here is the biliary origin of liver abscess usually have a multiple organism and usually multiple macro abscess. Second is following a portal vein. Benign etiology of portal vein invasion include a diverticulitis, appendicitis, anorectal infection, pelvic infection, postoperative sepsis, following intestinal perforation and pancreatic abscess and inflammatory bowel disease. Malignant etiology include any gastrointestinal malignancy produces perforation and following abscess formation spread via the portal vein and produces pyogenic liver abscess. And pyogenic liver abscess due to hepatic artery invasion. Mostly any systemic infection following endocarditis or vascular sepsis, septicemia, spread via the celiac vein, celiac artery, and spread via the hepatic artery produces multiple pyogenic liver abscess. The important feature here is the abscess usually multiple micro abscess. The biliary origin is usually a macro abscess, where the hepatic artery is usually a micro abscess. Biliary origin usually have a multiple organism, but the hepatic artery usually have a single organism. Pyogenic liver abscess due to a direct cause. Any penetrating wound, blunt trauma, following subphrenic abscess, perforated peptic ulcer, gangrenous cholecystitis following chemoembolization or percutaneous ethanol injection can produce liver abscess. There are other etiologies apart from the conventional four. There are cryptogenic abscess. In cryptogenic abscess, around 20% of the people, we don't have any exact etiology. Those patients will have either a diabetes mellitus or malignancy, and immunosuppression will have an abscess. And around 5% of the cases, there won't be any exact etiology. The abscess might occur following cyst infection or intrahepatic malignancy or following hydatid cyst infection. The bacterial pathology in pyogenic liver abscess. Most of the bacteria for a pyogenic liver abscess derived from the GI tract, around 75%. It has both aerobic as well as anaerobic organism. The most common organism is E. coli, which is most common in Western countries as well as worldwide. Whereas Klebsiella pneumoniae is most common in Asian countries. Other organisms also can produce pyogenic liver abscess like Pseudomonas. An anaerobic organism, the most common is Bacteroide fragilis. Another important thing in pyogenic liver abscess is in a hepatic origin liver abscess usually have a staphylococcus as a etiology rather than other bacteria. There are different clinical manifestations for pyogenic liver abscess. Patient will have a pyrexia, chills with rigors, nausea and vomiting. Patient might have a jaundice. Patient might have malaise and easy fatigability. There will be an upper abdominal pain, particularly right upper quadrant. And there will be a right shoulder pain due to irritation of the right duma flavum. The incidence of these clinical manifestations varies between the pyogenic liver abscess and amoebic liver abscess. The most common symptoms of pyogenic liver abscess is fever, around 81%, followed by weight loss, around 27%, nausea, vomiting, 25%, anorexia and right shoulder pain, around 25%. Rest of the clinical manifestations is very less. The signs, usually patient will have a right upper quadrant pain, around 53%. Hepatomegaly will be there, around 47%. And jaundice will be there, around 25%. The incidence of jaundice is more common in pyogenic liver abscess compared to an amoebic liver abscess. The earliest symptoms of pyogenic liver abscess usually are non-specific, like malaise, nausea, vomiting, weight loss, headache, myalgia. The most specific symptoms is fever with chills and rigors and abdominal pain. Abscess adjacent to the duodenum of the diaphragm might produce a pleuritic type of chest pain, cough or dyspnea. Septic shock might occur in the setting of obstructed biliary tree. Some patient with pyogenic liver abscess will have a peritonitis due to free rupture into the abdominal cavity. Hepatomegaly and jaundice is more common in pyogenic liver abscess. The list of investigation we want to do in pyogenic liver abscess. Protein investigation, we can see anemia and leukocytosis. Blood culture is positive around 20% of the patient with the pyogenic liver abscess. If you take liver function test, the most important liver function test will indirectly give an idea is elevated serum alkaline phosphatase. Elevated serum alkaline phosphatase is the most important liver marker for pyogenic liver abscess. Patient may also have an elevated bilirubin, aminone transferases and hypoalbuminemia. Next, we'll see the introduction and clinical manifestation of amoebic liver abscess. Amoebic liver abscess is the most common extra-intestinal infection of Entamoeba histolytica. Another important feature is it's most common in male as well as it's more common in alcoholic patient. It usually affects in a middle-aged male from 20 to 40 years. Amoebic liver abscess usually solitary in nature, most commonly affect in a right lobe of liver. But it can also affect the left lobe of liver, around 20%, and bilobular infiltration also can be seen around 5 to 10%. The liver abscess in amoebic liver abscess is usually thin capsule wall with the central necrotic material. It is typically have a odorless chocolate syrup or anchovy chaos pus, which is bacteriologically sterile. What are the risk factors for amoebic liver abscess? The most common risk factor we already discussed is alcoholism. There are other risk factors also for amoebic liver abscess like malignancy, HIV infection, malnutrition, steroid use, and disorders of cell-mediated immunity. Now we'll see the life cycle of Entamoeba histolytica. It has both intestinal and extra-intestinal route. See, mostly after defecation, the cyst and trophozyte passes in the feces, which become mature and form a mature cyst. The mature cyst is ingested by the human until reaches the intestine. Following reaching the intestine, it forms an extracystation. Extracystations spread via the portal vein and reaches the liver and produces liver abscess. The clinical manifestation of amoebic liver abscess. Usually, if you take the history, around 20% of the people will have a history of dysentery, and around 10% of the people will have a history of diarrhea or dysentery. There will be a pain in upper abdomen, which is the most common symptoms of amoebic liver abscess, particularly it radiates to right shoulder. And patient may also have a fever, which is abrupt in onset. And patient with the left lobe of liver abscess, pain may also seen in the left side of abdomen and radiate to left shoulder. Other vague symptoms like nausea, vomiting, fatigue, anorexia, weight loss might be seen in amoebic liver abscess. And another important peculiar feature is cough and dyspnea may be seen in amoebic liver abscess. Amoebic liver abscess is more common in males than females. Now we'll see the different signs related to amoebic liver abscess. Compared to pyogenic liver abscess, amoebic liver abscess jaundice is very rare. The cardinal sign of amoebic liver abscess is painful hepatomegaly. And palpation, liver is usually soft in nature and smooth, and the localized intercostal tenderness might be frequently seen. The movement of the right side of chest and diaphragm may be restricted with the dullness and percussion due to the abscess cavity. The blood investigation usually needed for amoebic liver abscess is the WBC count is raised, which is produces leukocytosis, and there will be a raised prothrombin time. If you compare between pyogenic liver abscess, amoebic liver abscess, pyogenic liver abscess will have an elevated alkaline phosphatase, whereas amoebic liver abscess will have an elevated prothrombin time, which is more specific, and also have a non-specific elevation of transaminases. If you take the fecal sample for a patient with amoebic liver abscess, you might detect trophozoites containing erythrocyte. But the important thing is, if you want to identify trophozoite, you should do a stool examination within 30 minutes following passage of stool. More than 30 minutes, the trophozoites may not be detected. An aspiration, we know amoeba usually present in the wall of the abscess cavity. So initial aspirate may not have an amoeba, whereas last portion of the abscess contain amoebic material. So if you want send for amoeba reduction, you should send the abscess at the last portion rather than the initial portion of abscess aspiration. And few more other investigation is useful to detect for amoebic liver abscess, like indirect hemagglutination test, which is most sensitive. In case of diagnostic dilemma, whether it's amoebic liver abscess or pyogenic liver abscess, you can use an indirect hemagglutination test, which is more sensitive, around 90%. But it may be negative in initial infection. If it is negative, it should be repeat after 7 days. Another important investigation is enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay, which is usually detected in most of the cases. Important things to be remember is a seronegative case may not exclude amoebic liver abscess. You have to either repeat or rely on other investigation. Now we'll take the consolidated difference between the pyogenic and amoebic liver abscess. So age, pyogenic liver abscess is more common in older age group with some comorbidities, whereas amoebic liver abscess is more common in middle age, around 20 to 40. Male is to female ratio is more or like equal in pyogenic liver abscess. Male is more commonly affected in amoebic liver abscess. Both pyogenic as well as amoebic liver abscess is solitary in nature, but pyogenic liver abscess around 50% might be in multiple. Location, usually both pyogenic as well as amoebic liver abscess affect both right lobe. The history of diabetes mellitus may be present in pyogenic liver abscess, but it's not common in amoebic liver abscess. Alcohol use is most common in amoebic liver abscess. Jaundice more common in pyogenic liver abscess because of the destruction, which is very rare in amoebic liver abscess. Elevated alkaline phosphatase is more common in pyogenic, whereas elevated prothrombin time is more common in amoebic liver abscess. Positive blood culture we can obtain from pyogenic liver abscess, but it's not possible in amoebic liver abscess. Apart from blood investigation, we rely upon imaging investigation for our initial screening as well as diagnosis for both pyogenic as well as amoebic liver abscess. Ultrasound is a good investigation which has a sensitivity around 80 to 90%. It can detect any hypoechoic lesion more than 1 cm. The important benefit of ultrasound in liver abscess is it can use for a diagnosis as well as therapeutic purpose. Next investigation is usually take is CT. CT with IV contrast will detect liver abscess around 95 to 100%. Usually in CT shows an hypodense lesion with the peripheral ring enhancement. Sometimes you can also see a double target sign and gas airway level detected around 20% of the lesion. Hepatic scan like technetium, gallium and indium are very rarely used in case of amoebic liver abscess. Now we'll see each imaging investigation in detail. First we'll see the X-ray. Any patient if come with upper abdominal pain, so usually always we'll take an X-ray abdomen or chest. X-ray abdomen might show satelectasis around 21%, elevated right diaphragm around 20%. You might also see a pleural effusion or pneumonia in chest X-ray with the liver abscess. X-ray abdomen may show septomegaly. Very rarely we can see the air fluid level within the liver. This is a feature of pyogenic liver abscess. This is an X-ray. We can see the elevated dome of diaphragm with air fluid level. An ultrasound in case of liver abscess. The ultrasound usually detects as small as 2 cm of liver abscess. Its sensitivity around 90%. The important feature of liver abscess in ultrasound is it has an hypoechoic round lesion with an echogenic wall. You can also see an acoustic enhancement with the internal debris. Another advantage of ultrasound in liver abscess is you can also use this investigation to identify what are the secondary causes of liver abscess, like gallstone or dilated intrahepatic biliary radicals or hepatolithiasis. The amoebic liver abscess usually have a round or oval hypoechoic area which is continuous with the liver capsule without significant wall in an echoes. This is an image of hepatic abscess with pleural effusion. Next, I will show the video of ultrasound with liver abscess. You can see the two abscess cavity. An ultrasound with hypoechoic round lesion in the right lobe of liver. This is abscess cavity 1, this is abscess cavity 2, this is the right lobe. Is a disadvantage of ultrasound. Even though ultrasound is used as an initial screening investigation, ultrasound has a certain disadvantage in liver abscess. Particularly, it may not visualize the entire liver dome. So it may fail to identify liver abscess located at the dome of the liver. And multiple microabscess with ascending cholangitis may not be well appreciated with an ultrasound. Sometimes, a patient with a fatty liver with liver abscess, the echogenic variation will decrease the sensitivity of ultrasound for liver abscess. Next, most important investigation in case of liver abscess is CT abdomen. The peculiar advantage of CT is it can able to detect a lesion as small as 0.5 cm. It has a sensitivity around 95 to 100%. Based on the seating imaging, pyogenic liver abscess can be classified into a microabscess or macroabscess. Any abscess less than 2 cm is called a microabscess, more than 2 is called a macroabscess. If contrast is administered, there will be a peripheral ring enhancement, which is a peculiar feature of pyogenic liver abscess. Usually, we'll use as a portal venous space with intravenous contrast material for differentiate between the liver and the abscess. So, the important phase we use usually is a portal venous phase. There will be a hypodense cystic area with the segmental wall enhancement with the surrounding low density edema may be seen in liver abscess. The pyogenic liver abscess has a peculiar character called a cluster sign or daughter abscess. And along with it, you have a target appearance with a ring-like enhancement around the periphery in pyogenic liver abscess. The transition zone between the low density central portion of the abscess and enhanced rim is typically narrow. This is a very important feature which help to differentiate between the liver abscess and the necrotic metastasis. Sometimes when you do ultrasound, it is very difficult to differentiate a necrotic metastasis and a liver abscess. So CT is very helpful to differentiate between these two parameters. Sometimes CT have some difficulty in distinguishing hepatic abscess, particularly a cystic disease of the liver and necrotic tumor. In those situations, we'll use MRI as guidance. The difference which is between the pyogenic liver abscess and the amoebic liver abscess based on CT. Pyogenic liver abscess will have a cluster abscess with a peripheral rim enhancement, usually solitary. If it's multiple, it's usually pyogenic in origin. Whereas amoebic liver abscess are well-defined abscess with a peripheral wall edema, mostly solitary in nature. Now we'll see the CT video of liver abscess. Here you can see the cluster sign. It's not completely homogeneous or oval or round shape. You have an air fluid level with the gas inside the abscess cavity. So this is a case of pyogenic liver abscess. When you use MRI in liver abscess, usually we won't use MRI as an initial screening investigation for liver abscess. We'll routinely not recommend. MRI can be only used to evaluate the blood vessel anatomy in a liver, particularly in patient where you can't use a contrast medium, particularly used in a CT scan. MRI is useful to differentiate between a liver abscess from other cystic lesion like cystic tumor or necrotic tumors. MRI is very useful in a pregnant woman with suspected liver lesion, either abscess or hiatal cyst. And another important advantage is MRI is helpful to differentiate between the liver abscess and a hiatal cyst. The MRI image of liver abscess. Next, we'll see a video how MRI is useful to differentiate between the liver abscess and hiatal cyst. This is a patient initially diagnosed as a liver abscess, but serum investigation is not diagnostic and shows some immunology suggestive of pentamoeba. So following CT, we did an MRI. MRI might show different daughter cysts inside the abscess cavity in a deep-weighted image. So MRI is very useful in differentiating liver abscess from hiatal cyst. Next, we'll go for a treatment option for liver abscess. Both pyogenic liver abscess as well as amoebic liver abscess have the same treatment protocol. Like it has a 4-stage of treatment, use and drug therapy like antibiotic in pyogenic liver abscess and metronidazole in amoebic liver abscess. Aspiration in those cases, we can't do a medical management both in pyogenic liver abscess as well as amoebic liver abscess, and percutaneous pigtail drainage, and 4th stage is surgical treatment. Each and everything we'll discuss now in detail. First, we'll see the medical management of pyogenic liver abscess. The antibiotic is a cornerstone of treatment for pyogenic liver abscess. We usually use a triple or 3 drug therapy like third generation cephalosporin or penicillin with aminoglycosin and metronidazole. This can be changed according to the pus culture and sensitivity report in pyogenic liver abscess. When to use medical management for amoebic liver abscess? all non-complicated cases, no feature of rupture or impending features, or there is no compression effect, we can use drug therapy in amoebic liver abscess. Drug of choice usually is metronidazole. The duration of the treatment varies between patient condition. So usually use metronidazole as a drug of choice around 750 mg 3 times a day orally for 10 days. Alternative drugs also we can use apart from metronidazole. This is a drug chart for amoebic liver abscess. You can use metronidazole 750 mg orally 3 times a day for 5 to 10 days. This is an adult dose. In pediatric doses, around 30 to 50 mg per kg body weight for 5 to 10 days. We can use other drug apart from metronidazole like chloroquine or tinidazole. Whenever you are using metronidazole, you should also use luminal amoebicide to kill the parasite like paramomycin, uroquinol, or dilaxanone furanic. You should use along with the metronidazole. What is the duration of the therapy? The duration of the therapy must be individualized, but the routine recommended protocol is intravenous antibiotic for initial 2 weeks, followed by an oral antibiotic for 4 weeks. But this protocol varies from author to author. Some recommend the duration of parenteral antibiotics up to 3 to 4 weeks, even 4 weeks, followed by oral regimen for 4 weeks or 6 weeks. The problem is multiple abscess is problematic that might require the duration of treatment up to 12 weeks. Both clinical as well as radiological prognosis is an important parameter should guide the physician to plan the treatment. When do we want to go a therapeutic needle aspiration? The indication of therapeutic needle aspiration and high risk of abscess rupture, particularly if the abscess cavity is more than 5 cm or left lobe of liver abscess. Why left lobe of liver abscess? Because there is high risk of rupture into the peritoneal cavity or pericardial cavity. Or treatment failure in which fever and pain persist despite of IV antibiotic following 3 days. Or when metronidazole is contraindicated, particularly patient with a pregnancy. Or patient will have a pressure symptom. To relieve the pressure symptom, you can go for a therapeutic needle aspiration. Or seronegative abscess, patient with a thin rim of abscess. Thus, the chance of rupture is very. When to plan a catheter drainage. So you can go for either therapeutic aspiration or catheter drainage. Catheter drainage only used in case of abscess is very thick, abscess cavity is more than 5 cm in diameter, abscess is very thick and non-collapsible, and multilocular pyogenic liver abscess. So now there is a confusion. When to choose a needle aspiration, when to choose a catheter drainage. So single abscess usually less than 5 cm, needle aspiration is preferable, or you can go for a catheter drainage also. But single abscess more than 5 cm, percutaneous drainage have a better advantage compared to a therapeutic aspiration. But few people will also recommend more than 5 cm surgical drainage is give a better outcome because the success rate is much higher than percutaneous drainage. What are the causes of unsuccessful catheter drainage? The catheter is too small to drain the pus. So the point is, whenever you use a catheter, you always try to use the catheter for complete drainage. Our position of the catheter is not adequate. So place the catheter in center of the abscess cavity so that drainage is adequate. Our catheter removed prematurely without complete drainage. Our thick fibrous capsule causing encasement of pyogenic liver abscess which is unable to collapse. So this is a CT image with a pigtail catheter in the center with an X-ray shows a pigtail catheter. Now we'll see the video how pigtail catheter was inserted. So following ultrasound guidance, the needle is punctured into the abscess cavity. Trial aspiration is done. Following trial aspiration, guide wire is passed to the needle. Once again, ultrasound used to confirm the location. As I already told you, you have to use multiple dilator to make the track big. If you place a small pigtail catheter, the chance of failure is higher. Use multiple dilator to make the track bigger. Now multiple dilator is passed via the guide wire. Finally, after maximum dilatation, the pictorial catheter is passed via the guide wire and positioned inside the abscess cavity. Final confirmation of the abscess aspiration is done via the pigtail catheter. This CT shows how pigtail catheter was inserted. So the needle passed via the intercostal space, reaches the abscess cavity, and pigtail is positioned in the center of the abscess cavity. What are the complications of percutaneous drainage? Even though the percutaneous drainage is done via the ultrasound or CT guidance, there are chances of complication like perforation of the hollow viscus, pneumothorax, bleeding, leakage of pus into the abdominal cavity, or reaccumulation of the pus, prolonged ileus, alveolar obstruction, pleural effusion, or recurrent abscess formation. When to first choose surgical drainage? When there is a coexisting intra-abdominal pathology that require simultaneous operative management, for example, patient with a liver abscess with an acute appendicitis or diverticulitis, you should choose surgical management rather than image-led intervention or failure of percutaneous drainage. Patient with multiple liver abscess or loculated liver abscess, which is difficult to drain via the percutaneous drainage, or abscess with the viscous content which obstructing the drainage catheter, or patient with ascites or pyagulopathy. If you pass a pigtail catheter in patient with ascites or pyagulopathy, there is a chance of intra-abdominal bleed or leakage of ascitic fluid via the pigtail. So you should choose surgical drainage. Or abscess with an intraperitoneal rupture, pericardial rupture, or pleural cavity rupture, or any complication occur following percutaneous drainage like bleeding or rupture. The surgical management of liver abscess, you can choose two options, either laparoscopic approach or open approach. Laparoscopic approach definitely has a few advantages compared to open approach. In open approach, we'll use a transperitoneal approach, extraperitoneal approach, then we have a hepatic vegetation. So laparoscopic approach is a minimally invasive procedure, so you can use simultaneous reduction of intra-abdominal pathology with the liver abscess. You can also use laparoscopic guided liver biopsy in suspected metastatic necrotic abscess, or you can place the catheter under laparoscopic guidance. Now we see the video of catheter placement under laparoscopy. So port is passed inside the abdominal cavity. You can see the abscess cavity. The needle is passed from outside inside the abdominal cavity under the vision. The puncture is made. Abscess is aspirated via the syringe. The drain is inserted. You can see the frank pus coming through the catheter. Open surgical approach can be a transperitoneal approach or extraperitoneal approach. In extraperitoneal approach, we have a subcostal approach, transpleural and retroperitoneal approach. First, we'll see the transperitoneal approach. Transperitoneal means through the abdomen. It's a standard treatment option for patient requiring surgical drainage. The abscess cavity is opened with the cautery after localization. The localization is broken with the finger dissection. The biopsy is usually taken from the wall because sometimes the abscess can be due to a metastatic necrotic material. The suction catheter is placed inside the abdominal cavity for a proper drainage. The drain usually removed after 2 to 3 weeks, depend upon the output from the abscess cavity. The open surgical method, you can can see the liver abscess here. The packing is done around the abdomen. First trial aspiration is done using a needle. Abscess cavity is confirmed. A suture is taken on either side. Using a diathermy, usually we won't do any hepatic resection and liver abscess. The hepatic resection only recommended in case of isolated lobar involvement with a single or multiple non-healing liver abscess, patient with the infected hepatic malignancy following hemoplia or hepatic abscess following chronic granulomatous disease. Is a video of hepatic resection. What are the risk factors associated with the liver abscess? The risk factors are septic shock, clinical jaundice, coagulopathy, leukocytosis, hypoalbuminemia, multiple liver abscess, intraperitoneal rupture, malignancy. These are the risk factors which is associated with the liver abscess. The complications of the liver abscess are numerous, like rupture into the lung or pleura can produce empyema, hepatobronchial fistula, pulmonary abscess, pneumonitis, pleural effusion. It can also rupture into the pericardium, intraperitoneal rupture, rupture into the portal vein, or a secondary infection might occur following liver abscess. How to follow up? So we treated the patient using a medical management or a therapeutic aspiration or percutaneous drainage. How to follow up the patient? The patient usually followed with the ultrasound. The mean time is taken for disappearance of abscess cavity usually around 6 to 9 months. The relapse is usually very rare, but presence of sonographically detected abscess cavity does not warrant continuing treatment around 6 to 9 months. There is two pattern of resolution based on ultrasound. There is type 1 and type 2 abscess. Type 1, whereas the complete disappearance of the abscess cavity usually occurs within 3 months. Whereas type 2 is there is rapid reduction of the space up to 25% in the initial time, then there is a resolution. How to predict the mortality? There are four independent risk factors which predict the mortality in liver abscess. First is bilirubin. Patient with the bilirubin more than 3.5, encephalopathy, large volume abscess cavity, presence of hypoalbuminemia, these are the independent risk factors for predicting mortality in liver abscess. Now we'll see the few interesting case report related to liver abscess. First is liver abscess due to fish bone. Following ingestion of the fish bone, which punctured to the intestine, reaches the liver, produces liver abscess. This was an interesting case report. Then fungal abscess in hydatidiasis. Sometimes hydatidiasis with the abscess have a difficult diagnostic difficulties, like diagnostic dilemma. And hepatic abscess and granulomatous disease. We could not be able to identify what is the exact etiology. Sometimes there will be hidden etiology like granulomatous disease. And sometimes hepatic abscess will have a different manifestation like ATL flutter. Just an interesting case report. One recent advances used in a liver abscess is endocavity contrast in an ultrasound. What you usually use in normal ultrasound, which has a lot of diagnostic difficulties. So we'll use an next investigation like CT, but an endocavity contrast in an ultrasound which helpful to detect what type of abscess and plan for further management. Thank you for listening. If you have any query, you are welcome.